want you to feel relaxed. We want you to feel at home. In fact, we'd love nothing more than after this week, as you look back, you would say that time that I spent at First Baptist Church on Easter morning was the best time of my entire week. That would be our hope. So if you have any questions or anything during the service, you need anything, you go out to the back of the sanctuary. There's guys back there that will answer your questions, direct you if you need to use a restroom, those types of things. We just want you to feel at home. Another thing that we'd love, if you're a visitor or haven't been here in a while, is we have something called a connection card. It's in the pew rack in front of you. You can see it up there on the screen. And that's just a way. We're not going to ask for a lot of information. We ask for a name and an email or a name and an address. And our hope is that we could follow up with you one time. All right, we're not just going to keep beating down your door, but we would love to follow up and say, thank you for coming. If there's any way we can minister to you, if there's any way we can reach out to you, we'd want to do that. So what you can do is if you would fill that information out in here in a few minutes when we take up our regular tithes and offerings, we don't ask you as a guest to feel obligated to put anything in the offering plate. That's not what we're about. That's for the faithful here who come and our members. But we'd love it if you drop that connection card in. That could be your gift to us today. Or after the service, if you go out these doors over here on my right, the first door on your as you go down the hallway is our welcome center. You can take that card in there and exchange it for a free gift. We'd love to give you a gift today that makes your life happier and reminds you of who we are and says welcome. And so again, we're delighted that you're here today. We're going to do some things a little bit different today. So for those of you who've never been here, just hold on, right? It'll feel normal. But to everyone else, it may feel like, well, you're doing things a little bit different, okay? But we're going to do some of the announcements that we do at the end. We're going to move the offering up. So I want to go ahead and do a couple of announcements. One, first, if you want to know more about us, all right, there's a few ways that you can do that. You could do that on Facebook. If you're on Facebook, you can check us out, First Baptist Kirksville. You can see some of the pictures that we have out there, some of the posts we make, find a little bit more of the flavor of who we are. Or you can go to our website, firstbaptistkirksville.com, and there's a whole slew of information out there that you can really dig in and see what we believe and what we believe the church is for and what our ministry vision is up here to magnify our Lord Jesus Christ by making, maturing, and mobilizing disciples. That's the essence, the core of what we want to accomplish and do and feel called to do. So you can do that and find out more about us as well. We also want to let you know about a few things coming up on Wednesday nights. We have a Bible study, a group that meets, and we want to invite anyone who wants to be a part of that to come. We're starting a new series on Wednesday, Habits for Our Holiness. All right, so we'll have a book that you can get, take home, read, come back each week, and discuss. And we're going to be talking about some of the habits that we need as Christ followers to live out this ministry vision that we have. So we hope you'll join us for that. Another thing we want to make sure you know about is our life groups. All right, maybe you're looking today and you're thinking, wow, I'd like to be part of a small group community, right? People who meet every week during the week to read scripture, to encourage one another, to pray for one another. That's what our life groups do. And we have life groups for singles. We have life groups for ladies, men, married, open groups for anybody. We have youth group. We have college groups. So everybody here fits in one of those demographics. And if you don't and you want to start your own group or you want us to start a group, we'll do that, okay? So we just really believe that this is how we learn and grow is in community together, all right? So we'd love for you guys to be a part of that. We're getting ready after this week to go into a new sermon series called Without a Doubt. And I want you to take a look at a quick video here with us. All right, a series called Without a Doubt, and we all live with certain doubts and fears. Maybe you're not like me. Maybe you're not afraid to sleep with the light out, all right? Maybe that's not your fear, but you've got questions and doubts in your life, right? And maybe you're going through something in your life right now, and your doubt is, does God love me? Does God even know I'm here? Maybe that's the doubt that you have. But we all face doubts at different times in our lives, and I really think this can be an impactful series for each and every one of us to come and know that we have a God who's not afraid of our questions, not afraid of our doubt, but who wants to offer us life, who wants to offer us the answers to those questions. So we want you to be back for that and invite people to come with you who we know would want to hear that message as well. Right now, what we're going to do is take an offering. And we normally do this at the end of our service as we feel coming out of worship that we give our tithes and offerings. And again, if you're a guest, no obligation. We don't want you to feel like you have to participate. But what we want to do is celebrate who God is and the opportunities given us to get this message about him out, this Easter message. How do we take this to the world? And right now we're doing a special offering. It's called our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And if you see the United States over here, we're filling it up, all right? Because we know through this offering that we want to send missionaries across North America and cover every state. And so I think we have about 4,800 raised so far toward our $6,000 goal. And we want to make sure that the whole United States is covered. In fact, one of our life groups has challenged the other life groups, if you remember, to sponsor a state for $100. In addition to what you're giving personally, that your life group might come together and sponsor a state. So if you haven't done that as a life group, it's something you might want to do. If you want to support this Easter offering today, we'd be delighted to do that because we want this message to go out. So I'm going to invite our ushers to come forward right now, and we're going to have a time of offering, and then I'll do a prayer at the end as we continue in worship. So let's have our offering right now. All right, as we continue in worship this morning, I just want to kind of set the stage for where we're going. Because today we really want the whole service to be a leading of life from death. But we have to start at death. And so throughout the series, we're going from a position of darkness. We're taking a position of the depravity of our sin and what it cost Jesus. And we'll talk about the cross and we'll focus on the gift that he gave us there as we move toward the resurrection and the life and the light. And I think you'll see that throughout the whole service this morning. And that's our prayer and our hope. And we do hope as well, as Jason shares in the message a little bit later, that God pursues us through all of it. Like from the beginning of time, before the foundations of time, he had a purpose and a plan, and he's carried that out. And we get to see that come to fruition, the fulfillment of that at Calvary, how he pursues us. He doesn't leave us abandoned, and he's always there when we return and follow him. So that's where we're headed today, and I pray that your hearts are ready for that. I know that that's our desire. So let's go ahead and pray right now and ask God to work powerfully. Would you bow your heads, close your eyes with me? Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for Easter and what it represents. That even though we were lost in our sin and God, that we failed you, you kept pursuing us. You showed your great love for us that while we were still sinners, that Jesus Christ came and gave his life and died on Calvary so that we could have life, God. And we thank you for the fact that it didn't stay there, but even after his death and he was laid in the tomb, that you brought life back, the assurance and the hope that we have because of who Jesus is. God, I pray this morning that this whole worship service would be a celebration, really, a time of worship of who you are and all you've done for us. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. As soon as it was morning, the chief priests had a meeting with the elders, scribes, and the whole Sanhedrin. After tying Jesus up, they led him away and handed him over to Pilate. So Pilate asked him, Are you the king of the Jews? He answered him, "You have said it." And the chief priests began to accuse him of many things. Then Pilate questioned him again, "Are you not answering anything? Look how many things they are accusing you of." But Jesus still did not answer anything, so Pilate was amazed. At the festival, it was Pilate's custom to release for the people a prisoner they requested. There was one named Barabbas who was in prison with rebels who had committed murder during the rebellion. The crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do for them as was his custom. So Pilate answered them, "Do you want me to release the king of the Jews for you?" For he knew it was because of envy that the chief priest had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd so that he would release Barabbas to them instead. Pilate asked them again, "Then what do you want me to do with the one you call the King of the Jews?" Again they shouted, "Crucify him!" Then Pilate said to them, "Why? What has he done wrong?" But they shouted, "Crucify him!" all the more. Then willingly to gratify the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. And after having Jesus flogged, he handed him over to be crucified.
Then the soldiers led him away into the courtyard, that is the headquarters, and called the whole company together. And they dressed him in a purple robe, twisted together a crown of thorns, and put it on him. They began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews." They kept hitting him on the head with a reed and spitting on him. Getting down on their knees, they were paying him homage. When they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple robe and they put clothes on him and they led him out to crucify him.
forced a man coming in from the country who was passing by to carry Jesus' cross. He was Simon, a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus. And they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means skull place. They tried to give him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his clothes, casting lots for them to decide what each would get. Now, when it was 9 in the morning, now it was 9 in the morning when they crucified him, the inscription of the charge written against him was, "The King of the Jews." They crucified 2 criminals with him, one on his right and one on his left. So the scripture was fulfilled that says, "And he was counted among outlaws." Those who passed by were yelling insults at him, shaking their hands and saying, "Ha! The one who would demolish the sanctuary and build it in 3 days. Save yourself by coming down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests with the scribes were mocking him to one another and saying, "He saved others. Why cannot he save himself? Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross so that we may see and believe." Even those who were crucified with him, were taunting him.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And at 3, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing there heard this, they said, "Look, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran and filled a sponge with sour wine and fixed it on a reed, offered him a drink, and said, "Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down." But Jesus let out a loud cry and breathed his last, then the curtain of the sanctuary was split in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who was standing opposite him saw the way he breathed his last, he said, "This man really was God's son." Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and the younger of the Joses and Salome. And when he was in Galilee, they would follow him and help him, and many other women had come up with him to Jerusalem.
We'd like to invite you now to stand with us as we sing the song, "At the Cross, Love Ran Red." Let's worship together.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all
Jesus on this Easter Sunday, would you say amen? Amen. You may be seated.
My soul, praise the Lord, and all that is within me, praise his holy name. My soul, praise the Lord, and do not forget all his benefits. He forgives all your sin. He heals all your diseases. He redeems your life from the pit. He crowns you with faithful love and compassion. He satisfies you with goodness. Your youth is renewed like the eagle. The Lord executes acts of righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He revealed his ways to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and full of faithful love. He will not always accuse us or be angry forever. He has not dealt with us as our sins deserve or repaid us according to our offenses. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his faithful love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us.
Good Friday. How can one describe such a day? The wrongdoing of all humanity, putting to an end an innocent man, the Son of God. This is the story of Jesus' death by way of a cross, all in one moment bringing death to the bright light of our future. He never stopped loving us, and yet this is the incredible part of it. Our sin stopped his heart. Our sin drove the nails firmly in the hands of God. All along, these were the plans. We told ourselves that we were in control, and this was deemed sufficient for all of us. The brutal beating, the inhuman flogging, the naked humiliation. Heaven watched and saw it all. Our rebellion, our guilt, our shame, erasing the very notion of reconciling us with God, our sin and our debt, overcoming Jesus. Here is our King, obliterated. The enemy laughing, his plans unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of freedom rising. Now God's people are utterly broken. Behold the chains of mortality. Yes, this is what is true. We had heard the stories of old. The lost are found, the blind can see, the weak are made strong. But now, we are witnesses to this reality. God is dead. We'd almost believed there is a way of redemption. There is a life of fulfillment. There is a peace beyond understanding. Now we know better. For us, we can say that God is encapsulated in this one realization. The single greatest sacrifice in human history is finished. How clearly we can see it. So what's so good about Good Friday? Just one thing. That the blood of Jesus can reverse the curse of sin and raise the dead to life. How clearly we can see it is finished. The single greatest sacrifice in human history encapsulated in this one realization. We can say that God is for us. Now we know better. There is a peace beyond understanding. There is a life of fulfillment. There is a way of redemption. We had almost believed God is dead, but now we are witnesses to this reality. The weak are made strong, the blind can see, the lost are found. We had heard the stories of old. Yes, this is what is true. The chains of mortality utterly broken. Behold, freedom rising. Now God's people are unstoppable. There's no longer the sound of the enemy laughing. His plans obliterated. Here is our King, Jesus, overcoming our sin and our debt, reconciling us with God, erasing the very notion of our rebellion, our guilt, our shame. Heaven watched and saw it all, the naked humiliation, the inhuman flogging, the brutal beating, and this was deemed sufficient for all of us. We told ourselves that we were in control. All along, these were the plans firmly in the hands of God. Our sin drove the nails. Our sin stopped his heart. And yet, this is the incredible part of it. He never stopped loving us. The bright light of our future, all in one moment, bringing death to death by way of a cross. This is the story of Jesus, the Son of God, an innocent man putting to an end the wrongdoing of all humanity. How can one describe such a day? Good Friday.
That video, I think that video is cool, just the way it really is. It's all pivoted on the resurrection of Jesus. It's all about what he has done for us, and today is that day that we celebrate that. Today is the day that we celebrate Jesus's not death on the cross, but his resurrection from the grave. In fact, in old Christianity, whenever they would meet someone alongside the road, they would come up to him and they would say, "Christ is risen." And the response, do you know the response? He's risen indeed. So today we celebrate that. We're excited about that. We're connecting with a core group of people all around the world for centuries that have gathered together on this day to celebrate what Jesus has done. This confession, the confession that Jesus is alive, is the central confession to our faith. We as Christians, when we talk about the death, when we talk about the resurrection of Jesus, it is everything to us. And today I want to show you a story that I believe illustrates what happened when Jesus died on a cross and rose from the grave. Because you see, I think it is all about one simple thing. It really is all about God's great love for us. You see, that's really the story of the Bible. The story of the Bible is this simple. It's God's great love for us. That's the story of the Bible. That's the story of Easter. That's the story of me. That's the story for you. God loves you. God's great love for us. This is why we celebrate. From the very beginning of creation, God had a plan. God had a plan to restore us, to bring us into his family. He loves us so much, he comes after us, desperately seeking after us, desperately looking for us, desperately wanting us to be with him. Think about that for a moment. God's great love. One of my favorite stories in the Bible I want to share with you today, it's kind of a story some of you may not associate with Easter, but hopefully after today you'll see why Jesus told us this story. Charles Dickens said this is the finest short story ever written. It's found in the book of Luke. So if you got your Bibles, Luke chapter 15. If you don't have your Bible, there should be one in the pew rack in front of you. You can grab a hold of that, or we will put the scriptures on the screen as well. But today I want to walk you through one of my favorite stories, one of my favorite parables that Jesus told, and you may know it as the prodigal son. And at the end of the message, I'm going to offer you a chance to respond. I'm going to offer you a chance to trust Jesus as your Savior. If you've never done that, if you've never allowed Jesus to come and to save you from your sins, at the end of the message, I'm going to give you that opportunity to do that. Now, here's the story. Again, this is not just some quaint little parable, some quaint little story. I really believe this is a story that summarizes God's desire for each of us. It's the story of the cross. It's the story of the resurrection. Again, it's the story that you know as the prodigal son. There's three main characters in this story. There's this son who runs away. There's the father who is desperately watching for his son. And then there's an older brother in the mix as well. Now, first, first, before I even begin, I want to tell you a few things that people get wrong about this story. Everybody thinks that this young boy who runs away is the main character, and I don't believe that the boy running away is the main character. In fact, I believe the father is the main character in this story. In fact, 12 times in 20 verses, the father is mentioned. I believe that it all is centered around the father here. And the second thing people misunderstand is this word prodigal. A lot of times when you hear this word prodigal, it's associated with the son, the prodigal son, the one who leaves. And well, the word prodigal, I looked it up, I Googled it and tried to figure out what it means. And it's really wastefully extravagant. Or here's another translation, giving on a lavish scale. Now think about this, if the word prodigal means wastefully extravagant or giving on a lavish scale, who's the real prodigal in the story? Is it the son? Well, I think he did waste extravagantly, but check this out. Maybe it's the prodigal father, because it's the father who gave on a lavish scale. Our Father gave on a lavish scale. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have her everlasting life. Have you ever thought about how extravagant, have you ever thought about how lavish our Father gave to us? He gave his Son on a cross to pay for our sins. Well, let's look this morning real quick. We sang a bunch today, so I got less time to preach. Y'all know that's probably not true. Y'all hope it's not true, don't you? Now you hope it is true. Anyway, let's jump into Scripture. If you got your Bible, Luke chapter 15, I want to start reading a few verses, and then I'll stop and talk about God's great love. Verse 11 says this, he also said to him, a man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the estate I have coming to me. So he distributed the assets to them. Now, basically, I think some of you may have understood this, and you know what this means. The young son, he wants his dad's money. He says, I want your money, but I no longer want you. Basically, what he's basically saying is, Father, I wish you were dead. Give me my inheritance so I can go out and I can spend it. I can go out and use it. Now, I can't imagine a more painful thing than a son or one of my sons, one of my daughters, coming to me and say, Daddy, I wish you were dead. I mean, I'm sure that happens when they're teenagers. But I don't look forward to it, okay? I don't look forward to the time of where they say, I wish you were dead. I don't even want a relationship with you any longer. We don't even want to be around you. We don't want our kids to know you. Just give us your money and get out of our lives. That's basically what's taking place here. Now, what Jesus is doing is giving us a great example of what sin is like. Sin in our life is exactly that. And that's something that we've all participated in at some level. It's basically saying, we don't want you, God, in our life. We don't want your control over our life. We don't want your values in our life. We don't need you any longer, God, because we want to be in control. I've heard someone say, and in fact, I was teaching it to my oldest son this past week, sin is really this word that has this big I in it. Right in the middle of sin is I, the letter I, right? S-I-N. And that's what sin is really about. It's all about I. I want to be in charge. I want to be in control. I want to be the point of the story. People think sin is just one of these heinous, one of these awful moral acts that includes these big things that, oh, those sinners over there. But really, sin is just boiled down to this. I want to be in control. I want to run my life, not you, Lord. So here Jesus is telling this story, and he's telling this story, and it's really revolved around sin. And he's saying sin is whenever you want to be in control. Sin is whenever you want to run everything. And that can happen with God, and that happens to us all the time. We look to God and we say, God, I don't want you in control of my life. I want to run it. I want to make the decisions. I want to do it my way. Basically, what you're saying is just like this son said to the father, I don't need you. I want you dead. Get out of my life. Now here comes one of the most surprising aspects of this story. Did you notice the last sentence of this verse? This is really surprising. It says, so, and he, and that's talking about the father, so the father gave him the money. So the father distributed the assets to them. He says, okay, here you go. Here's the money. Now, it's interesting why I said this is surprising, because the book of Leviticus actually says the father had the right to kill his son. And you say, that'll keep him straight, won't it? You come and rebel against me? He actually had the legal right to kill his son. Or New Testament scholars say there's this word, that kezezah, which actually means that what they would do is they would all come, all the leaders of the community would come together at the gates, and if a son rebelled against their father, they would take a clay pot and they would break it in front of the community. And when they broke it in front of the community, it was symbolic, and kezezah is what they called it, and it meant we are cutting him off. We're kicking him out of the... He's not going to rebel against the family. He's not going to rebel against the father. We're kicking him out. We're not even giving him anything. And that's complete opposite of what the father did. The father gave him everything. Instead of killing him, that would have been bad, instead of kicking him out with nothing, he did the complete opposite. He gave to him. So that's the first thing I want to share with you. The first point this morning is this. Check this out. I really believe this is true. God loves us. God loves you, even when you didn't even care about him. Have y'all stopped to think about this? God loves us, even when we didn't even care anything about him. Before we repented, before we wanted to come back to him, before all of that, God has set his love on us. This is why I can stand up here today and preach this one message to everybody that's in this room. Everyone that's in this room, listen to this one simple thing. I can tell you with full assurance right now, God loves you. No matter how far away from you, even before you are a child of him, he loves you. He loves you. He has this desire for you to come be a part of his family. This child, he had no right to be loved by the father. Basically, he was saying, Dad, I wish you was dead. And yet we see, even when he didn't deserve it, even when the son didn't care about the father cared about the son. Well, let's keep reading the story. Verse 13 says this, not many days later, the younger son gathered together all that he had traveled, all that he had, and traveled to a distant country, where he was squandered his estate. That's where we think about this prodigal. Squandered his estate in foolish living. After he had spent everything, a severe famine struck that country and he had nothing. Then he went to work for one of the citizens of the country who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. He longed to eat his fill from the carapavs, basically the food that the pigs were eating. And no one would give him any. Here he was starving, he was wanting this desire. And again, let me tell you what we can learn about this. God loves us even when we run away from him. Even when you run away from him, here we see this boy, and this boy took all of his stuff, he packed his bags, and he ran away. Now let me point this out. This guy's life, it started great. The guy's life started great. He went to a far country, and he started spending his money. He had a lot of friends. Things were going well. And then all of a sudden, the winds of change began to blow. He ran out of money. He ran out of friends. And he started, feeding pigs. He ended up in the pigsty. And again, I told you the first point showed us a picture of sin. This shows us the trajectory of sin. Let me tell everyone this morning, if you're here today, and let me tell you where sin will lead you. Sin will lead you into trouble. Sin will lead you away from God. Sin will lead you into the pigsty, if you will. How many of y'all, now listen, I want to begin by saying this. Sin's not all bad. Wait a minute, did the preacher just say that? I hate it when preachers stand up and say, you know what, sin is horrible. Sin is terrible. Let me tell you why I say this. There's a verse in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 25, it says this, there is pleasure in sin. Did y'all know the Bible said that? There's pleasure in sin. I always tell somebody, if somebody says sin is terrible, I always think, well, you probably are not doing it right. there's pleasure in sin. There's pleasure in sin, right? That's why we do it. There's pleasure in sin. Well, I told you, Hebrews 11:25, that's the first part of the verse. There's pleasure in sin, but there's a second part of the verse. Got a little too hot back here, I guess. The second part of the verse is this. There's pleasure in sin for a season. There's pleasure in sin for a season. It's for a season. It's for a little while. And maybe that's why some of you are here this morning. Maybe some of you are here this morning, if you really looked at your life, if you really looked at your heart, you're in sin right now. Maybe it's some sort of sexual sin. Maybe it's some kind of a pigsty of a broken relationship. Maybe you've got family issues that you're struggling with, or some of you are dealing with financial issues, and you're in debt, and you're barely struggling, and you're barely making it, or maybe it's whatever it is, you've got this sin that's just eating away at you. And I'm going to point this out. You may be in pleasure now, but it's only for a season. It's only for a little while. And maybe that's why you're here today. You feel like you're in a far country, and I just want you to know this truth right here, okay? Look at me. If you're here this morning, and maybe someone invited you to here today, and you're just here as a guest, you're just here to make your parents happy, or you're just here to make your friends happy, and you don't... God loves you even when you're running away from Him. Even when you're in the middle of sin, God loves you. It's almost like you can see this picture in this story of a split screen. On one side, you've got this son, and he's just in the middle of a mess. He's in the middle of the pigsty. He's in the middle of mess. He's in the middle of the sin. But on the other side, on the other side of the split screen, you've got the father. And the father's sitting there, and he's waiting, and he's watching, and he's looking, and he's longing for his son to come back into his family. That's our Father. In fact, let me show you that. I love this part of the story. It keeps reading. Verse 17 says, when he came to his senses, he's talking about the son. When he came to his senses, when he finally woke up, when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired hands, their servants, have more than enough food? And here I am dying of hunger. I'll get up and I'll go to my father and I'll say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired hands. Now check this out. I love this in verse 20. So he got up and he went to his father. But while the son was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion. And he ran, threw his arms around his neck, and kissed him. Listen, I love this picture because here's what this lesson teaches me. God loves us even when we don't deserve it. Isn't that an awesome thing? God loves us even when we don't deserve it. I realize I don't deserve God's love. Any of y'all with me on that today? You see, here's the thing. This is the third story of this type that got Jesus told in Luke chapter 15. The first one was this lost sheep. The shepherd had 100 sheep and one of them was lost. So the shepherd left the 99 to go find that one sheep. He was desperate to find that one sheep. He left everything to find that one sheep. The second story is about a woman who lost a coin. She had 10 coins, she lost one, and she tore her house up to find the one. She was desperate to find that one coin. Did you kind of hear this word that was happening over and over? The shepherd was desperate to find the sheep. The lady was desperate to find the coin. And now we come to this third story. Now I think of a sheep. I love my dog, and if it got lost, I'd be sad. I love my money. When I lose my money, I get sad. But if I lost my kid, I would be desperate to find him. In fact, last summer, you know, I've got these two twins. They're 2 years old and they're trouble. That's all they are, just total trouble. I've got one who's even more trouble than the other. I got this boy, his name's Gray. My littlest boy, Gray. He's kind of like, I want to put a tracking collar on him. I mean, I need something on him. He's got to have eyes on him at all times. Because you never know what he's doing, never know what he's getting into. Well, last summer, as it was supposed to happen, Sarah was supposed to be watching the kids. Actually, I was supposed to be watching the kids, which means she better be watching the kids because I don't do a great job at it. So anyway, I was supposed to be watching the kids. She thought I was watching the kids. I just assumed she was watching me watch the kids, making sure I did it right. And she comes in and she says, well, where's Gray? I'm like, I thought you got Gray. And that's always my assumption. No, she doesn't have Gray. I don't have Gray. So we searched the house. We were picking up couches. We were looking under sheets. Where's Gray? Don't know where Gray is. The screen door was open. Gray went outside. He went out the front door. He walked out towards her. My in-laws are here. Y'all cover y'all's ears right now. Okay, y'all here. So all of a sudden, we found Gray out by the road. He's alive. He's safe. It's okay. Don't call Department for Human Services. He's alive. But we had lost him. And let me tell you, while he was lost, we were a little nervous, freaking out a little bit. Because who knows, this kid, let me tell you, he could end up in Georgia before we know it. He's fast. He just run. I don't know. So if y'all see a little two-year-old running around, stop him. It's probably my turn to be watching him, and don't tell Sarah. Okay, we'll make that a little. But let me tell you, when you're losing a kid, let's go, parents. Be honest. Parents, how many of y'all lost your kid before? Come on, don't make me feel better. Come on. Raise them high. I mean, y'all been at the mall, you've been at Walmart, you've been somewhere and you looked around and your kid wasn't beside you. Let me see. All right, the rest of y'all lying? Lying. I mean, it happens, okay? It happens. And when, and I want y'all to feel, you feel that in your gut can you remember that? That sickness? I want y'all just a moment and feel that. And now think about this. Our Father in heaven desperately is looking for us, is desperately seeking us. We are lost, and he wants us found. That's the story right here. Even when we don't deserve it, this son comes back, and he's found by the Father. This is the climax of the trilogy that Jesus is teaching us here. Is this desperate need for the Father to find the Son. Now listen again, God uses things to bring us back to him. And maybe you're here this morning and God is seeking after you. God is trying to bring you back to him. And maybe it's pain that God is using in your life. Maybe it's a broken marriage. Or maybe it's a failed career. And right now your life is a mess and you've got pain. Well, let me tell you what that pain is there for. It's asking you to come back to him. Or maybe, listen, maybe you're growing up and you've got these kids now and you realize you've got a new responsibility and you've got to get these kids, you know, on the right track. And God's using that as an opportunity for you to get your life back. He's trying to bring you to himself. Listen, I've spoke to people over and over. Maybe it's a scare of death. Maybe it's an illness. You're sick. You found out you've got a disease. You've got cancer. Or your grandparents have passed away and death is heavy on your heart right now. And God can use that to bring you back into a relationship with him. That's God knocking on your heart. That's God speaking to you saying, listen, I want you to come back. Listen, I'm not a prophet or anything, but I believe there's people in here today, this morning, and God is doing exactly that in your life right now. He's speaking to you saying, I love you. I want you to come back into the family. Listen, it's not an accident you're here today. It's not just because your parents invited you, or it's not just because your friend sent out an invitation. You're here for a reason. And maybe just now it's to listen to this message. Look back at verse 20. Look back at verse 20. It says, while he was still a long way off, his father saw him, had compassion, and ran. You know what? Grown men don't run very often. I mean, unless they like playing sports. You ever thought about it? Grown men don't run. You see me running, somebody's chasing me. I'm just saying. I mean, you see a grown man running in the mall or running down wall, either he stole something or he's trying to catch somebody who stole something, right? I'm just saying. So here you got this father done rolled up his robe and started running towards the son. And then I love this, it says, and he threw his arms around him. He embraced him. And he kissed him. I just want you to ask yourself, have you had that moment with God? Have you had that moment when suddenly the Spirit of God's voice speaks inside of you and speaks to your spirit, and you hear the tenderness of God's voice, and God's voice just whispers in your heart. He says, Jason, I love you. Have you had that moment where God just whispers into your heart, I love you? He threw his arms around his neck and kissed him. Now, if I stop and if you stop to listen, I think that's what God is speaking to us right now. I love you. I love you. Let's keep reading because I want you to hear the next part of the verse. Verse 21 says, and the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Now remember, he had this whole thing. He was going to, this whole speech planned out, right? And at the beginning of the speech, the father just cut him off. But the father told his slaves, I forget all that junk. I ain't even worried about your whole speech. I ain't worried about that. The father told his slaves, quick, bring out the best robe. Put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Then bring out the fattened calf and slaughter it, and let's celebrate with a feast. And this leads to the last thing I want to share you today is, listen, God loves you so much, he wants to shower us with grace. I love this picture. He loves us so much, he wants to shower us with grace. Did you go back and see what the father gave the son? He said, hey, go get a robe. Now think about it. He said, go get the best robe. The best robe probably belonged to the father. And he said, go get my robe and put it on the son. Hey, go get a ring and put it on. The ring was a symbol of authority. Hey, the sandals. Now listen, servants didn't wear sandals. Only sons wore sandals in the house. So basically he's saying, you're not a servant, you're a son. Go be my son again. Go be my son. Here's the father just giving grace, grace upon grace upon grace to the son. I was sitting there asking myself, where's the shame in this story? Where's the punishment in this story? Who pays for the reckless living that the son did? Punishment's not there. Shame is not there. The father took on all that, didn't he? None of it was on the son. It was all on the father. And that's the story of the resurrection. That's the story of the cross. Let me explain to you now why this story is a picture of Jesus' death and resurrection. Because you see, the cross was Jesus running after us and taking our sin, taking our shame, taking our punishment. It was Jesus paying for it all. He was beaten. He was spat upon. He was whipped. He was crucified on a cross, taking the punishment of our sins. You understand what the cross is? It was Jesus taking your place. It was Jesus paying the price of your sin. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. There's a payment that must happen because of our sin. The Bible says, for all have sinned. I've sinned, you've sinned, we've all sinned. And because of our sin, there must be a payment. And Jesus gave it to us. He paid that price. See, God is the true prodigal, lavishly giving us this free gift of salvation. And this morning, he's wanting to give you a robe of righteousness, where we come to him with sin. He takes our sin and he gives us his righteousness. He wants to give you a ring of authority. You can have boldness as you enter into the throne room of God. He wants to give you sandals as a son. You're no longer an enemy of God, you're a child of God. You see, this morning, I want you to know and I want you to hear that God loves you. The cross and the resurrection, if they're not true, this is just some nice little story. But if they are true, it means that none of us are beyond the reach of God's grace. If you're here this morning and you just think, not me, I'm nowhere near good enough, let me give you good news. You're never out of reach of God's grace. Your history does not determine your destiny. God's bigger than that. There's nothing you can do, or there's nothing you could have done to make God love you more. His love is free to you. Grace. Someone defined grace as God's riches at Christ's expense. You and I get the position as a son because of Jesus. God's perfect son paid the price for our rebellion, for our sin. So let me ask you this morning, will you receive God's gift? Will you receive God's gift of salvation? Some of you I haven't met before or haven't seen before, but one of my favorite questions I love to ask people, whether I'm filling up with gas and the person who's next to me is filling up with gas, or someone that I'm just sharing my faith with, let me ask you this. If you died today, do you know what would happen to you? If you died today, do you know you'd go to heaven? Or do you have questions? You have doubts? If you're here today and you realize that, listen, I've made mistakes in the past, well, good, we all have. The Bible says, for all have sinned. We all have. We've all fallen short of God's glory. But today is an opportunity for you to start fresh, to start new. God wants to take all of your junk, all of your past, all of your sin, and He wants to forgive you. He wants to clothe all of that with His righteousness. He wants to give you everything today. Will you accept it? Here's my question for you. Have you had that experience? Have you prayed and asked Jesus to save you from your sins? Right now, if you will you just bow your heads right where you are? Just close your eyes right where you are. Where do you see yourself in this story? How many of you are like the son who's run away? How many of you are like the son that's run away and just gone? How many of you this morning, you realize you've got sin in your life that needs to be forgiven? Right now, nobody's looking. All eyes are closed. If you're looking right now, or everybody, head bowed, eyes closed, if you realize you've got sin in your life that needs to be forgiven, will you just raise your hand right now? I need to be forgiven. Raise your hand. I need to be forgiven. Thank you. Thank you. I see hands. Let me ask you this. Would you step out this morning? Would you ask God to forgive you of your sins? Just right now, where you are, this is a simple prayer that God, I've realized I've made mistakes. I've realized I've fallen short. I realized I've sinned, God, and I am asking for forgiveness. The Bible is very clear. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. If you confess your sins, He's faithful and He's just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Is that not a great promise? You confess your sins, He's faithful, He's just to forgive your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. This morning, you can have forgiveness if you just ask. Those of you who raised your hands, would you say that prayer? God, forgive me of my sins. God, forgive me of my sins. If you really need salvation, maybe some of you, if you died today, you're not sure that you'd go to heaven. Some of you need salvation. You need to be saved. You need to know that you're going to heaven. It's quite simple. It's simple as this. It's admitting you're a sinner. We've kind of just talked about that. But secondly, it's believing this story that I talked about. It's the story of Jesus. Jesus came and he lived a perfect life and he died on the cross for your sins. He rose from the grave. He is God. Do you believe that? Just confess that to God right now. God, I believe that. I believe that. The last thing I want to encourage you to do is this, is commit to follow him. I want to follow him with my life. He is worthy. He is worthy of all of it. I want to commit to follow him with my life. If you prayed that prayer right now, all heads are bowed, nobody's looking around at you. If you prayed that prayer for God to save you, if you prayed that prayer for God to forgive you and for God to come into your life, would you just raise your hand? I just want to pray for you right now. I see several. Any others? Any others? Who prayed that? I see several. You asked God to save you from your sins. Any others? Great. Okay, put your hands down. I want to pray for you right now. Father, those of you who made decisions right now, God, I pray that you would convict them, continue to speak to them, God, and show them that you are real, to show them that what they have desired is happening. God, you say if they confess with their mouth, if they believe in their heart, they will be saved. So God, I pray that you'd give them the courage to step out and to talk to someone about this decision. God, maybe they need to come to me, or they need to come to Charles, and they need to come to whoever brought them here today and just say, listen, I made that decision today. I need to go follow up with that. God, I pray that you would grow them in grace, grow them in Christ, help them to grow up to be mature believers. Help us today as a church to give you glory, to worship you for who you are and what you've done. We love you, Jesus. We love you. Amen. Let me tell you, if you made a decision today, if it was a decision just for your sin, if it was a decision to give your life to Christ, let me invite you to do something. At the end of the service, Charles and myself, we're going to be down front down here. We're not going to embarrass you. We're not going to point it out. We're just going to be down front, shaking hands, hugging necks, and all that kind of stuff. But we want you to come see us. Let us follow up with you. Maybe you've got some more questions. Maybe you just need some more information about what you've done. Those of you who raised your hand, I saw you, and I'm not going to point you out. I want to embarrass you, but I want you to come find me. This is Charles. Charles, come find Charles at the end of the service and just come ask for a little more information, okay? Let us help you find Christ. Well, you know what? Today we've kind of made a transition. We started very dark with just the cross, but we're not ending dark. We're ending with the resurrection because Jesus is alive, right? He is alive. He is alive indeed, and we celebrate that. In fact, let me read one more section of Scripture with you before I let you go. It's talking about the resurrection. It says, in the evening of that first day of the week, the disciples were gathered together. Hey, that sounds familiar, doesn't it? Here we are, gathered together, but we don't have the doors locked, with the doors locked because of their fear of the Jews. And then Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace to you. And I love this. Look at what they did. And having said this, he showed them his hands and his side. So the disciples, what'd they do? Say it again. What'd the disciples do? So the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. After saying this, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. Will you do what the disciples did this morning? Will you join hands? Let's stand up and let's rejoice. Rejoice that Jesus is alive. And then I want to send you just as Jesus sent the disciples. Send out and tell people about Jesus.